Morning. Isn't God good? It's funny how he works in our lives. Susie, your special was great. The funny thing is the passage you used is one of the ones I'm using today. So it's been funny how he works that out for us. You go all week long. I mean, I was working on this week and wasn't sure which direction to go, because our title is Who to Pray. You know, we as Christians, we know who to pray to. We know that we pray to God through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. What more than that is there? That in itself answers the question, who do you pray? The other question is, who do you pray for? Today, we're going to speak on that. This is the third part of a series that we started 2 weeks ago. I spoke on when to pray. Last week, Jeffrey spoke on where to pray. Next week will be our last week of this series, and it's on how to pray. Going through this week, I was trying to figure out what to do and how to do this, because it leans so much going into how to pray. So I was trying to have to pull myself away from how to pray to who to pray. Our main emphasis for this from the passage that Dave read was from verse 6, the last part of verse 6. Pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father, which seeth in secret, shall reward thee openly. In Exodus, Moses asked for God's first name. What a powerful introduction. Moses wanted to know who he should tell Pharaoh had sent him. God's response, I am who I am. He is the living, eternal, ever-present, self-existent, holy, unchanging one. This personal name of God is so holy that many Jews would not speak it out loud or even write it in paper. It's why when Jesus used the phrase, I am, he was accused of blasphemy. In a world full of idolatry, the people of the Old Testament worked to make certain no mistake could be made regarding the identity of the one true living God. In our world today, still full of idol worship and also idol hearts, we too need to be aware of the one true living God. What we understand from stories and stats about unbelievers who pray or request prayer is that a person can value the idea of prayer without knowing the one to whom they should pray. As believers, we want it to be known that we pray, but also to whom we pray. And ultimately, we want our prayers to be useful tools to introduce the world to the God that we are praying to. Scripture shows us to pray, who to pray to. Prayer is our communication to God and helps us to grow closer and more intimate to him. Zechariah 13:9. This third I will put into the fire. I will refine them like silver and test them like gold. They will call on my name, and I will answer them. I will say, they are my people, and they will say, the Lord is our God. Sorry, I'm using my tablet today instead of printing it out. I went to go print out my sermon and realized I didn't have any paper at home. So I'm trying to use my tablet at the same time. So, in Psalms 5, 1 and 2, it says, give ear to my words, O Lord, consider my mediation. Hearken unto the voice of my cry, my King and my God, for unto thee will I pray. Those two passages right there shows us that we pray to our God and that he is there. We're going to show a short clip from War Room. This is a, for those that have seen it, this is the spot where Elizabeth prays and walks through the, as she's walking through the house. It's pretty amazing watching it and seeing how she's, how her conviction is there.
I don't know where you are, devil, but I know you can hear me. You have played with my mind and had your way long enough. No more. You are done. Jesus is the Lord of this house. And that means there's no place for you here anymore. So take your lies, your schemes, and your accusations and get out in Jesus' name. You can't have my marriage. You can't have my daughter. And you sure can't have my man. This house is under new management, and that means you are out. And another thing, I am so sick of you stealing my joy, but that's changing too. My joy doesn't come from my friends, it doesn't come from my job. It doesn't even come from my husband. My joy is found in Jesus. And just in case you forgot, he has already defeated you. So go back to hell where you belong and leave my family alone.
Wow. Don't you wish we could pray like that all the time? What this doesn't show is right at the end of this scene, the daughter is sitting on the stairs, listening to the whole conversation that she's having. Can you imagine the impact that it had on her daughter as she's sitting there listening to her mom, kicking Satan out of the house and accepting the Lord into her life, into that house to manage that house? That's how we should be. Maybe not so dramatic, because then people might think we need to go to a loony bin or something. But the thing is even in our hearts, in our minds, we should be that way. We should be that excited about it. Praying in the name of Jesus means that we come to the Father. We come because Jesus Christ shed the blood, his blood on the cross, not only for sins, but so that we could come to the Father in his name. How can we be any more intimate than that? Having faith is crucial in our prayer life. In Hebrews 11:6, it shows us that we need to have faith. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. We must follow God and believe all things are possible. We need to believe, even if we don't get rewards. He is still there. If we believe that God exists and that we have faith, then he will reward us in his time. It may not be right away. It may not even be something big. It may be something as small as making you smile. In 1 John 5:14, it states, "And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us." That is important. We need to ask anything according to his will, not ours. There's too many times that we pray for our will, not for God's. If God wills it, it'll happen. But we need to make sure we pray in his will. In Matthew 6:10, which is part of the Lord's Prayer that Christ was teaching his disciples, it states, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven." Even Christ was teaching us that we need to follow God's will, not ours. In 1 John 5:14, it states, "And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us." And then in Psalm 66:16-20, "Come and hear, all ye that fear God, and I will declare that he hath done for my soul. I cried unto him with my mouth, and he extolled with my tongue. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. But verily, God hath heard me. He hath attended to the voice of my prayer. Blessed be God, which hath not turned away my prayer, nor his mercy from me." It may not seem like God has heard our prayers, but he has, because we pray to an awesome God. He hears us and takes into account everything in our lives, for our God is a God that responds. In the movie Courageous, I was watching it this week, and there was a scene in there that actually popped in my head as I was doing my sermon. Javier is a gentleman in there that he was working temp jobs. He got fired. He was praying to God that he would get a job. He gets a call, and he walks to work because his car was on empty, and he left it for his wife and his kids so they could go to the store if they needed to. He walks to the job. He's too late. He gets there. The guy said, "I just hired the last guy. I don't need anybody else." So he was in despair, and he starts walking home. He walks down this alley, and he stops to pray to God. He's going, "Why? Why are you doing this to me? Why is this happening? God, it's in your hands. What do you want me to do?" Then all of a sudden, Adam, who is a cop, comes out and yells his name. "Javier, hey, come over here." He's going, "Who's calling me?" Then he sees Adam. He walks over. Adam was expecting a guy by the name of Javier that his partner was going to send to him to help. So he was thinking this Javier was the Javier that was supposed to come work for him. But it wasn't. It happened that other Javier got sick and he was in the hospital. So even though we don't realize how God answers our prayers, he does. That was a response to his prayer. Next thing he knows, he's working with this guy, with Adam on the shed. Adam gets him a job at a thread factory in town, and he's set. He's now making a living for his family, all because of his faith in God. He was able to continue doing what he needs to do, and God answered his prayer, and he responded. The Bible shows that our God responds to our prayers. In Jeremiah 33:2-3, "Thus saith the Lord, the maker thereof, the Lord that formed it, to establish it, the Lord is his name. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things, which thou knowest not." He is also a God who blesses us. In Matthew 7:7-11, it states, "Ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth, and he that seeketh, findeth, and to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. Or what man is there of you whom is, if his son ask bread, will give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask him?
How has God answered your prayers?
I know he's answered prayers for me. I'm sure he's answered prayers for you. One of the prayers that I know that he's answered for me is several years ago, when I left BSU, I called up a friend and he needed some help. So I went up to Wyoming to work with him. I ended up being up there for almost 2 years. And then I came back to Idaho and I'm still working for that same company. However, my buddy, who is the general manager of the company, his wife also works for the company. And we've never really seen eye to eye, even prior to me working for this company. And now me working with the company, I have to work with her quite closely. And there was a lot of times that she was very rude to me, very condescending to me. A lot of it is because we saw things differently. But I started praying about it because I didn't know what to do. I didn't know if I should stay with the company or should I move? Should I find another company or another job to go work for? God answered that prayer. And right now, the two of us have worked together for the last almost year without her being rude to me or condescending. We actually have joke around with each other now and we talk and without any animosity between us. The thing is, it doesn't matter if you have animosity or if you don't like someone. You still pray for them and you help them. Because if you have a positive attitude toward them, they're going to in turn see that. And through God's prayer and his help, he will change that and make it so that it's a better relationship with you. It makes it so that your job is that much more funner. And it shows them, and it shows you, that God does respond to your prayers. While doing my research this week, I came across a music video by Stephen Curtis Chapman. I haven't really heard him or listened to him since I was back in my college days, back in the early 90s. So I thought it was kind of cool to see that he was actually still making music. And it's called Warrior. And it talks about prayer. And so I want to play it, and I want you guys to listen to the lyrics as he sings.
Fighting riding on the left and on the right. So I fall on my knees and I fight like a warrior. I am a warrior on my knees when I call on the name of the one who is conquered. I'm more than a conqueror when I believe. The enemy trembles every time, 'cause he knows no longer mine. When I fall on my knees and I fight like a warrior, like a warrior, like a warrior. Our weapons are trust, our weapons are hope in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He says I'm tremble. We will fall on our knees and fight like a warrior. We are the warriors on our knees. We call on the name of the one who is conqueror. We are the conquerors. We believe. The enemy trembles every time, 'cause he knows the battle isn't yours or mine. When we fall on our knees and
I heard that and
I just leapt for joy in my heart. Because how true is that? When we go to our knees and we pray to God, He is our conqueror. He is our shield and our sword. There's a couple of scenes in there that actually brought to my attention that I remembered as I was watching it. See the lists on the wall of the girls' room and the closets? And in Miss Claire's closet. And then she had a list of prayers answered. She's not just praying about herself. She's praying for herself. She's praying for other people. That's what we need to do. We need to pray for other people. That God can open our hearts and open their hearts. And bring us to where He needs us to be. We may not like the answers that He provides for us at times, but He answers it for a reason. Sometimes that helps us build our character and builds us to what God wants us to be. This week I challenge all of you to pray to God for His guidance in our lives, in your lives, and the lives of everyone in this church. May He show all of us what He wants us to do. I'm going to ask the song leader to come forward, and while he does that, I like to do a prayer. This is a prayer that I found that really hit me when I was reading it, and as I was looking at it, and I decided I'd do it today. So if we'd all bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, help us to be filled with Your word, love, power, and peace. That even when we are under attack by the enemy, our heart and our faith will not waver. Our confidence is in You,
Help us to remember that when trouble does come into our life, we don't have to be afraid because you are with us. Lord, we lift up our hands to you and ask that you would extend your hands to us and lift us up above all the trouble in our life. Take away all fear and torment and help us to find rest in you. We thank you for your promise that you will never leave or forsake us. We thank you that you are always our help in time of trouble. And with you by our side, we have nothing to fear. Help us to face each challenge with hope in our hearts. Through the grace of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Earl. If we'd all take a hymnal, we'll turn to hymn number 159. We're going to sing, I Must Tell Jesus, hymn number 159.
I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear my burdens alone. In my distress, he kindly will help me. He ever loves and cares for his own. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me, Jesus alone. I must tell Jesus all of my troubles. He is a kind, compassionate friend. If I but ask him, he will deliver, make up my troubles quickly and end. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me, Jesus alone. Tempted and tried, I need a great Savior, one who can help my burdens to bear. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus. He all my cares and sorrows will share. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, Jesus can help me, Jesus alone. Oh, how the world to evil allures me. Oh, how my heart is tempted to sin. I must tell Jesus, and he will help me. Over the world, the victory to win. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, Jesus can help me, Jesus alone.
Almighty God, it is again with the privilege and honor to come before you, Lord. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, that we can share all our burdens and sorrows with. And Lord, we know that you hear each and every one of us and that you'll meet us where we are, Lord, and that you'll answer our prayers, maybe not always to our liking, but Lord, what is best for us and in your will. And so we thank you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.